Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the commencement ceremony for the Horace Gray class of the Western Michigan University School, Cooley Law School. The graduation is set to begin in a few minutes, and we respectfully ask that you silence your electronic devices. Out of consideration for all attendees, we ask that guests remain seated during the ceremony. If you have young children and they are not finding the graduation as enjoyable as other guests, we ask that you take your little one into the lobby. A picture of each graduate will be taken as they receive their diploma. These pictures will be made available to graduates and their families. The ceremony is also being videotaped. Information regarding how to download the ceremony is available through the bookstore. Thank you for attending, and we appreciate your cooperation in making this day a special one for our graduates, as well as a safe, enjoyable, and dignified commencement ceremony. My name is Chrisrion Scott, the host of the graduation. Today, we will graduate our Masters of Law and Juris Doctorate candidates. The assembly is requested to stand while the invocation is pronounced by Professor Linda Kizabeth. Remain standing after the invocation for the national anthem.
Good afternoon and welcome. Before I begin the invocation, I want to congratulate all of our graduates. I also would like to congratulate and thank all the parents, family, and friends who have supported our graduates through this very challenging and exciting period in their lives. Now, let's please take a moment and silence our thoughts and clear our minds. Whatever our faith, religion, or beliefs, let us now bow our heads and go to that source of life's energy and hope. It is with gratitude that we are here today to celebrate these law school graduates, who they are, what they have accomplished, and the lasting impression they have left on us. Now is the time to pray for continued support and guidance. Together, let us lift up these graduates with thankfulness and love. May they be thankful for the ability to learn and grow in knowledge of the law and its importance in our world. May a passion for the law always shine brightly in their hearts so they find a way to do their part to ensure the rule of law as the pathway to a peaceful and civilized world. May they ask for blessings to be successful in the bar exam and in establishing their careers. May they always have the strength and courage to do what is right and ethical in their decisions when faced with legal dilemmas. May they bring a swell of hope and help to those who struggle or are downtrodden and are in need of their guidance and wisdom. May they do their very best to honestly and ethically work through the legal system to uphold the values and candor and integrity and make a better way for our profession and those who depend on us. May they take responsibility, be leaders, find answers, provide guidance, advocate and teach, and move their communities forward, and always remember that the legal field calls on them to be a trusted member of society as a representative of our great profession to which they will soon be called. May they begin each day with optimism and confidence. And may they look back on their graduation day today, in the future, and find it to be one of the most memorable events, which will lead them to a long and successful life where they find peace, invigoration, and deep satisfaction. This we ask and pray and hope. Amen.
Please join in singing our national anthem, which will be led by Susan Anzik.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming. And the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Please be seated. The valedictory will be presented by Katrina Davis, who was selected by the Horace Gray class to present the class's farewell comments.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you. First, giving praise, honor, and glory to my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is the head of my life, the faculty, the staff, esteemed guests, family, and friends, welcome. Welcome. What a great honor and pleasure it is to speak for you all and on behalf of the Horace Gray graduating class of 2021. I can't lie, if y'all can believe it, I was nervous about speaking today. I mean, because what do you say to such an intellectual group of people? A normal graduation speech? What does that even mean? You know I'm not normal. Heck, none of us are. We are part of the 0.01% of the U.S. population that graduates from law school. And y'all, if you don't believe it, I would say you are all quite extraordinary. Our law school journey has been amazing. We have some of the best faculty and staff in the world. And I believe that with my whole heart. We all weren't just a number at Cooley. These men and women genuinely cared for our well-being. They cared about our education, and they are passionate about us learning the law and ultimately passing the bar. They are eager to help us at every turn, and I know we've all experienced that. That was the biggest surprise to me about law school, that every event, every organization, every mixer, every appointment, and all of these office hours, they are offering of themselves to help us become effective leaders and lawyers. I can go on and on about y'all, because I know for a fact that I, nor many of us, would not have made it had it not been for the fervor and the passion of this faculty and staff. And I would not change this experience for the world. I must say that in addition to the faculty and staff, the best part of being in law school for me was plain and simply all of you. Like, I love y'all. I really do. To be in a class with you all, to feed off of your drive, your motivation, and your eagerness to learn the law made this experience bearable and very enjoyable. So to my classmates, again, I love y'all, really, with all of me, I do. Most of you don't even know how inspiring you are to me and everybody around you. We have interfaced each other in different classes, in different organizations, online, most recently, and you have come from all different experiences, all different backgrounds. However, we shared one hope, one goal in common, and that's to become a lawyer and make a difference in the world. I believe in y'all so much, so much. And I know if we've accomplished graduating from law school, because this was no easy feat, we can absolutely succeed at anything we put our minds to. Y'all can do it. I promise you, reach for the stars. So as we leave here and go off into our respective fields in the legal arena, in whatever you do, know that you are enough, and you've always been enough. And of course, we could have not done this without all of the people who are with us every step of the way, to our families, friends, mentors, and colleagues. We love you, graduates. So in just one second, I'm gonna have you stand up. I'm gonna have you turn around. I'm gonna have you find your person, your people, and just tell them how much you love them. Tell them thank you, blow kisses, give air hugs, whatever. So on a count of three, I want y'all to stand up and we're just gonna show our love in that way. So one, two, three. I love you, Mom, Dad, Christina, Jennifer, Momo, Cruz, I love y'all. Y'all are so loved and they are so proud of you. I'm so proud of you. That's not even part of my speech, but you guys are inspirational. My God. Y'all, families and friends, we love you. We love you. So just know that throughout our journey, your presence, your words of encouragement, your spirit, it kept us going, and we thank you so much. Family and friends, we love you. We thank you so much. And as we go forward, remember, graduates, that everything you have been through, you have already made it through. And everything that you're going to go through, you got this. Don't forget your greatness. And hey, so in my closing, I want to share with you the lyrics for one of my favorite songs. That has gotten me through many dark days. It's by an artist named Donnie Hathaway, and he says, hang on to the world as it spins around. Just don't let the spin get you down. Things are moving so fast. Hold on tight and you'll last. Keep your self-respect, your manly and your womanly pride. Get yourself in gear, keep your stride. Never mind your fears. Brighter days will soon be here. So let's celebrate today and focus on passing that bar the first time. And last but not least, thank you. Thank yourself. Pat yourself on the back. Those long nights, those early mornings, the stress, the coffee, the energy drinks, it was all worth it. We are here together. Graduating from law school. We made it. You, we have all made it. And we're lawyers. We have a JD. God bless you all. And remember, I love you. I love you. I love you. And keep on going. God bless you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is my privilege to present to you the President and Dean of Western Michigan University, Thomas M. Cooley Law School, James McGrath, who will provide opening remarks and introduce the commencement speaker.
Thank you and welcome everyone. Before I give my formal welcomes, I'd like to say a few quick thank yous. First of all, I'd like to thank Sharon Scott, who is our host today. Great job so far. I'd also like to thank Professor Linda Kizabeth for her very uplifting and inclusive invocation. And also Susan Anzik for her wonderful performance, as usual, of our national anthem. Thank you very much. And finally, to Katrina Davis for her very heartfelt, inspiring farewell address. Well done, Katrina. Go ahead, please. So December 18th, 2021, it's a special day for all of our graduates and their families. You know, often our graduation falls on a date of special significance. Just last year, one of our graduations was on International Day of Education. That's great for people who spent half their life in school, right? And just recently in Tampa Bay, it was 9/11, and it was the 20th anniversary of the attacks on 9/11. So a very auspicious day, very easy to remember your graduation date. But what about December 18th? What's special about December 18th? Well, I did a little research, and I want you to know that it's, National Twin Day. Well, hang on. National Roast Suckling Pig Day. National Answer the Phone Like Buddy the Elf Day. Now, the best one we got here is National Baked Cookies Day, but it's not exactly the gravitas I was looking for memorializing our graduates' great accomplishments here today. But I'm hoping you'll all look fondly back on December 18th as a very special day, and maybe a good day each year to reach back and contact one of your fellow graduates you may have lost touch with, because I know most of you are going to stay in touch over the years because of the bonds you've made here together, suffering through the rigors of law school, a bond you'll have for life. Now, our graduates today are about to become lawyers. They'll have earned very special powers, and with those powers come commensurate responsibilities to serve. And what an awesome responsibility to be a member of this noble profession, particularly at this time of uncertainty. I know we're all sick and tired of COVID, and we all talk about wanting to go back the way things were pre-COVID, but probably never going back the way they were. And maybe that's a good thing, right? We're going to see courts are still going to hold many proceedings online or virtually, and all kinds of businesses are re-examining business as usual. So you could look at these current times as a time of confusion and concern, or you can look at it as a time of incredible opportunity, a chance to make meaningful changes that our world desperately needs. Now, I can't tell you what to do to be an important part of that positive change you want to make in the world, because we must all find our own paths. I only hope that we can respect and encourage each other as we work to positively shape the future. And as we face new crises, and there will always be new challenges of some sort, we have an opportunity to learn from the past, fix what needs repair, and build a shared understanding of equality, justice, and inclusion in the new era that we must create. The world needs you, and I know you're ready to lead. All right, well, most of you know that because of the pandemic, all of our graduates today left classes one day in 2020, March 13th, and law school became virtual. And as you see, things aren't quite back to normal yet. Everybody here except me at the moment is wearing a mask. We have extra safety precautions, but this will get the job done, because that's what WMU Cooley grads do. You get the job done. So let's get this graduation done. Let me offer a big hearty welcome to all of you, to our distinguished guests, and our amazing staff, many of whom are working behind the scenes here today, our wonderful faculty, many of whom are appearing here on stage, and of course, the reason we're all here, welcome to our graduates of the Horace Gray Class of 2021. Thank you so much. I also want to give special thank yous to everyone and everyone who helped our graduates get through law school. Whether you're a family friend, family member, or anyone in our grad support system, you all knew how committed our graduates were. And thank you for the support you gave them. Maybe it was emotional support. Maybe it was financial support, thank you. Maybe it was just running through flashcards with them. Whatever you did, thank you so much. And I would like to say, however you were here for your grads, it's over. I'd like to say that, but it's not over yet, all right? We have one big hurdle left, and I'm not the first to say it here today, thank goodness. Usually I'm the Debbie Downer. It's that bar exam. So today we celebrate your success, and you've earned a well-deserved break. But very soon you're gonna have to get back to the challenge of preparing for that bar exam. So to all of our family and friends, please bear with us and the graduates for one more big effort. But enjoy this special day. Now it's my incredible privilege and pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, Justice Richard Bernstein. Justice Richard Bernstein became the first blind justice elected by voters statewide to the Michigan Supreme Court in November of 2014. With a commitment to justice and fairness, Bernstein began his 8-year term in January 2015. Prior to being elected to Michigan's highest court, Justice Bernstein was known as a tireless advocate for disabled rights as an attorney heading the Public Service Division for the Sam Bernstein Law Firm in Farmington Hills, Michigan. Blind since birth, Justice Bernstein is a Phi Beta Kappa graduate of the University of Michigan and earned his Juris Doctorate from Northwestern University School of Law. Committed to taking action to help clients who needed him, Justice Bernstein's cases often set national standards protecting the rights and safety of people with and without disabilities. Among his cases in private practice, he represented the Paralyzed Veterans of America in partnership with the United States Department of Justice in an action against the University of Michigan to allow for safe access for disabled individuals when the university's alterations to the stadium failed to accommodate and represent disabled visitors. This case helped establish guidelines that are used by all commercial facilities all across the country. He also successfully partnered with the United States Department of Justice to force the city of Detroit to fix broken wheelchair lifts on its buses, establishing a precedent for accessibility in public transportation. Further, Bernstein represented disabled veterans against the Oakland County Road Commission after roundabout traffic circles were built without disabled access, impacting future ADA compliance for road construction throughout the United States. In a landmark settlement against Delta Airlines and Detroit Metro Airport, Bernstein gained accessibility for all disabled flyers, helping set the standard for which airlines and airports are to be covered under the Americans with Disabilities Act of 1990. He's a big proponent of education. He argued for and won preservation of a special education funding throughout the state and filed a federal suit against the American Bar Association, thank you, to put an end to its discriminatory practices toward blind students via requirement of the law school admissions test. He also challenged the city of New York to make Central Park and all parks for visitors, all visitors inaccessible for disabled and visually impaired individuals. Bernstein previously served an 8-year term on the Wayne State University Board of Governors, elected by voters statewide, serving as its chair from 2009 to 2010. He also served as an adjunct professor in the Political Science Department at the University of Michigan. Honors Justice Bernstein has received include Michiganian of the Year, shouldn't that be Michigander? By the Detroit News, and one of Crane Detroit Business's 40 Under 40, in recognition on worldwide television by CNN as a leader in keeping government honest. He was selected by the Young Lawyer section of the State Bar of Michigan as the 2003 to 2004 Regina Merrick Outstanding Young Lawyer. He is also an award recipient for outstanding commitment to public service and is the recipient of the 2008 John W. Comiskey Pro Bono Award from the State Bar of Michigan in recognition of his leadership as an advocate and an activist. Michigan Lawyers Weekly named Justice Bernstein a 2009 Leader of the Law, and the University of Michigan presented him with the James T. Naubacher Award in 2011 for his unwavering commitment to equal rights and opportunities for people with disabilities. So the same year, L. Brooks Patterson, Michigan's Oakland County Executive, selected Judge Bernstein to serve as one of the region's elite 40 under 40. In 2013, and here we take a little turn, Justice Bernstein was inducted to the National Jewish Sports Hall of Fame. Because in his spare time, Justice Bernstein is an avid runner, completing 22 marathons, including 13 New York City marathons. And for those of you that don't know, a marathon is 26.2 miles. All right. He's also run the full Ironman triathlon in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho in 2008, and the Isserman triathlons, half Ironman, and Eilat Israel in 2011. And if you don't know what an Ironman marathon is, it's a race that starts with a 2.4-mile swim. And if you look at a football field, you'd go across it 4,224 times to swim that many miles. That's a long swim, followed by a 112-mile bicycle ride, and then a 26.2 running marathon, all raced in that order. It's widely considered one of the most difficult one-day sporting events in the world. And he's also previously co-hosted a one-hour legal radio show called Fighting for Justice on WCHB AM 1200 in Metro Detroit. I am so honored that this very busy crusader for justice made time for us today. Please help me in welcoming Justice Bernstein.
May God bless all who are here today. May he bless you and your families. May he keep you safe. May he keep you healthy. And may he allow for you to find your way. Let us ask a spiritual question. Why is it that if God is so good and so merciful, he allows for bad things to happen to otherwise such fine people? And why is it that there are some who come to know a greater struggle, greater hardship, greater challenge, or greater difficulty than others can possibly imagine or even attempt to comprehend? And why is it that during these difficult days, a wonderful writer penned that the streets of heaven are too crowded with angels tonight? People ask, what are the qualities that go into being a good lawyer? What are the qualities that go into being a good jurist? And so often you'll get responses that come back like this. Oh, it's all about what school you went to, your academics, your curriculum vitae, your ability to research and to write and to publish, your academic journals. And I am here to tell you today that none of those things matter. None of those things count, and none of those things are remotely relevant. What allows for you to be a good lawyer, or a good judge, or a good servant, is your life experiences. And the reason that I love this institution, and the reason that you are going to be the leaders, is because the experiences that God has given each and every one of you. It is only through struggle. It is only through hardship. It is only through difficulty that you can come to know, understand, and appreciate the struggles and the hardships and the challenges that your friends, that your neighbors, and that your colleagues have to endeavor and experience each and every day. You're the ones that matter. Nothing has been given to you. Nothing has been made easy for you. Nothing but hard work, determination. Nothing but your raw willpower and your raw passion. You don't have that sense of entitlement. You have to work for everything that you've accomplished and everything that you've achieved. You have to work because you have jobs. You have to work because you have families. You have to work because you have kids. And yet, you're right here. You're up all hours of the night. You're up throughout the weekends. It is through your discipline and raw tenacity and focus and absolute determination that is what got you here to this point. And it is through your purpose and your passion and your energy and your sacrifice that you will take the experiences that God gave you and you will use them to impact and affect the lives of those who exist around you. For you live your life with a sense of meaning. You live your life with a sense of mission. You live your life with a sense of passion. You live your life because you understand why you were created. You understand what you were sent here to do. You understand what your ultimate mission is. No, nothing has ever been easy for you. But it is through that that you have an energy and a tenacity and a resilience like no other. It is through that that you will never take no for an answer. It is through that that when obstacles or challenges are put before you, you know how to navigate. It is through that that you serve with a sense of humility, that you have a sense of modesty that guides you through your days. God has chosen each and every one of you for a reason. He certainly did not make it easy. He made it as hard as possible. But why else would you have these experiences but to do something with them that's going to be great and that's going to be profound? So why is it that bad things happen to otherwise such good people? And why is it that there are some who come to know, like you, a greater struggle or greater hardship or greater challenge than others can possibly imagine or even attempt to comprehend? For so many of you, you have had to deal with insurmountable loss or setback or discrimination. You've had to deal with so much. And so often people will come to you and they're going to say to you, as you're dealing with that loss, as you're dealing with that setback, as you're dealing with that struggle, they're going to come to you and they're going to say, oh, things are going to get easy. Things are going to get better. You're going to make a total recovery. Or I am certain that you will attempt or hopefully find closure. But so often in life, as everybody here today knows, understands, and comprehends all too well, that often is the case that we don't always get better, that we don't always get to recover, and that we will never have the opportunity to find closure. But the reason that you are here today, and the reason that you are going to go forward tomorrow, and the reason that we are all counting on you, and the reason that we all need you, is because you understand all too well that it's not always about finding a way to recover from our obstacles or our discrimination or our setbacks or our health reversals or the loss that we've come to know and have to live with. But it's all about the ability to adapt. The way that you have gotten to where you are is that you know how to adapt. Adapt to the challenge. Adapt to the setback. Adapt to the frustration. Adapt to the hardship. Adapt to the discrimination. Adapt. You have learned how to adapt to a new life or a different life, or the life that you didn't anticipate, or the life that you didn't want, but the life that has been chosen for you. The reason that you're here is because you have been able to thrive through adapting to new circumstances, to new situations, and to new outcomes. So why is it that bad things happen to otherwise such good people? And why is it that you have come to know some hardships and difficulties and struggles that others have not been given? Everybody here knows that life can change in an instant. It can change without warning, and it will change without notice. Now, you heard in the introduction that I have been blessed to have had the opportunity of completing 25 marathons and a full Ironman competition. As you heard in the introduction, an Ironman is a 2.4-mile swim followed by a 112-mile bike to be completed by a 26.2-mile run. So I invite you to picture, if you would, the feeling you would have as you dive into a frigid body of water. The water temperature that morning of Lake Coeur d'Alene was 55 degrees. Imagine swimming in total darkness, having no idea where you started, having no idea where you are, being the only blind competitor, you repeatedly get kicked in the face by all the other swimmers, and not being able to see, you can't brace for the ensuing impact. Other competitors become entangled and ensnared in the rope that connects you to your guide. And as the rope constricts, it starts taking you below the surface. You try to get oxygen, but it becomes impossible as the waves come crashing down upon you. And ultimately, you start to feel that drowning sensation. The reason that we all believe in you so heartily, the reason that we are all counting on you, and the reason that we all know that our future is in your hands is because you have all had that same emotion. You have all had that same feeling, that sense of pain, that sense of uncertainty, that sense of anxiety when you don't know what the future has. And what you have all come to find, which is why you are here today, and why you will be here tomorrow, and why you are going to do extraordinary things, and why you are destined for greatness, each and every one of you, is because you come to find at certain points in life that yes, our bodies are mortal, and yes, for so many of us, we are infirmed. But it's always us, the people who get counted out. It is always us, the people that have to work so much harder. It is always us, the people that have to go farther. It is always us, the people who simply can never get a break. It is always us, the people that have to prove themselves over and over and over again, that come to have the strongest and most powerful and most resilient of spirits. And it is always us whose souls transcend the surly bonds of earth, touch the heavens, and pierce the face of God. So why is it that bad things happen to otherwise such good people? And why is it that there are some who come to know a greater struggle or greater hardship or greater challenge than others? It was a beautiful day in New York Central Park. As I walked in the pedestrian lane, I've memorized the loop that serves as a circumference of the park. It was Monday, August 13th, 85 and sunny. I was in mint condition. I had just finished my 17th marathon. And as I walked on that circumference, in the pedestrian lane, a bicyclist was traveling at a speed of an excess of 35 miles an hour. And due to such a high rate of speed, when he hit the park's biggest fill at 90th Street, he could no longer maintain control of his bicycle. and unfortunately veered into the pedestrian lane where I was walking and struck me directly in the back. Now, a 35-mile-an-hour impact is catastrophic, to say the absolute least. And I share this story because it relates to everyone who is here today. You reach up to the heavens and you say, "Why?" As a person who's born blind, I always used athletics to find my purpose, to find my strength, to have that sense of independence. And now I have to live at New York's Mount Sinai Hospital for over 10 weeks. Every single person in this room knows that feeling in some sense. We are always the ones who have to work hard. We are always the ones who have to rise to the occasion. And yet, whether it's an accident, whether it's a life experience, whether it's a work experience, it seems like we are always the ones who have to start at the beginning. It seems like we are always the ones who have to start all over. It seems like we are always the ones who, I always have said before, can never get a break. But you come to realize from these experiences, as I did, as you will, that life is never about the big things. It is always about the little. You miss what it's like to have the chance to use the bathroom. You miss what it's like to take a shower. You miss what it's like to sleep through the night without having to writhe in a pain that is indescribable. People used to come and visit, and they'd always say, "Oh, when I leave the hospital, I'm going to go and visit some friends. I have to go back to the office. I have more things to do." I'd always tell them, the way that you live, the way that you understand, the way that you have become lawyers, it is those simple things that so many people long for. It is those simple things that so many people crave. It is those simple things like being treated with respect, like not being discriminated against, like having the opportunity to find work. It is those simple things. In my situation, like having the chance to get fresh air, or be outside, or go on a bus, or be in a restaurant. You understand that as you become lawyers, you are going to fight for those simple things. You understand what it's like for people to be treated with that sense of respect. You understand that the one thing that people crave, the one thing that your clients want, is their sense of dignity and their sense of respect. And it is through those experiences that you will begin the practice of law. And you will have a passion, you will have an energy, you will have a sincerity, and you will have, as said before, a sense of humility towards your clients, towards their pain, towards their difficulty, towards their hardship. You are going to be the kind of lawyers who understand and appreciate what it means to serve. And I ask each and every one of you to celebrate every victory and every accomplishment and every achievement that you have been a part of. In my situation, I would celebrate the fact that I could finally sit up in bed. I would celebrate the fact that I could use my leg. And I would celebrate the fact that with a lot of effort and work, I could find my way to the nurse's station at the end of the ward. Now, in my short time with you left, I'm going to share with you one story that I believe helps us to understand who we are and the journey that we are on as attorneys, as judges, but ultimately as servants of the public. After getting released from the hospital, It was time for the New York City Marathon. Now, this would be my first marathon after a catastrophic incident. It wouldn't be fast, it wouldn't be easy, there would be no PRs. But it would be a marathon nonetheless. And as we ran to the streets of New York and began crossing the 59th Street Bridge and started running up First Avenue at mile 18, I remember the pain was becoming so severe and so intense that I could feel the battle raging within my spirit. I could feel the thunder, the wind. I could sense the lightning and the anger and the frustration that I had over why have things happened the way they have happened. And I reached up to the heavens and I prayed to the Creator and I said, let me have this. Let me have this moment. Let me cross that finish line. Let me have the chance to make it. And I am certain that every one of you here today has had that same experience. When you're sitting at your kitchen table, while you're trying to work with your family, while you're dealing with your spouse, while you're dealing with your professor, while you're dealing with all of the challenges that come at you at once, you have that sense of frustration. You have that sense of anger. You have that sense of rage, and you reach up to the Creator and you say to Him, let me have this. Let me have this moment. Let me have this accomplishment. Let me have this achievement. And ultimately, what today represents is the thing that we have all looked for, the thing that we have all prayed for, and the thing that we have all asked for. And for me, at that moment, at that time, on First Avenue, at mile 18, I could find what I was always trying to seek. I was able to find and make my peace with God. So why is it that bad things happen to otherwise such good people? And why is it that there are some who come to know a greater struggle or greater hardship or greater challenge than others? The answer goes something like this. Every one of you knows this. We all come, as you all have done, to a certain point where you can't spend your time and your energy and your effort trying to get over it. For we come to realize there is simply no other alternative but to just get on with it. For you are the ones who will do what is hard and achieve no less than what is truly great. And you are the ones that live life like a great story. And within that story, there will always be chapters. Chapters of pain, setback, and heartache. But it's only through those chapters that you will come to find hope, joy, and experience what you've experienced today, the sense of ultimate triumph. For it was deep into the night as the angel came upon Jacob, and there existed an immense battle, and that battle raged until the dawn. And when the sun rose, the angel blessed Jacob and gave him a new name. The name of Israel, which as we all know, translates to mean one who struggles with God. But we also know that Jacob was not left uninjured. He would live with a limp. He would have a broken hip. He would know pain for the remainder of his days. And I believe Scripture tells us this, for it was only through Jacob's setback, it was only through his pain, it was only through his frustration, it was only through his disappointment that he could connect, that he could understand, that he could empathize, that he could ultimately lead. We're given our experiences for a reason. If I hadn't been given the experiences that I had been given, I wouldn't be a very good judge. I wouldn't be kind. I wouldn't be merciful. I wouldn't be understanding. I wouldn't be empathetic. You are the ones, as you've gone through life, who have basically been able to replace dreams with wisdom, You are the ones who celebrate the experiences that you are given, for good and for bad. You are the ones who celebrate the journey that we are on. But most importantly, you are the ones who have come to know all too well that yes, we are mortal. Yes, we are infirmed. But it's always those people who have the strongest of spirits, the most beautiful of souls. It is always those spirits and those souls who do nothing less than reach the heavens and live without limits.
It is now my privilege to introduce Associate Dean of Academic and Student Affairs, Amy Timmer, who will present the candidates for graduation.
Justice Bernstein, how am I to follow that? Except to say that it is going to be my great pleasure to introduce those very people that you spoke of. Ladies and gentlemen, in a few moments, the members of the graduating class will be receiving their degrees. This is an important and solemn occasion, and we request that all persons in the assembly remain in their seats during the ceremony until all degrees have been conferred. Graduates from each of the law school's campuses will proceed together. The faculty of the Western Michigan University Thomas M. Cooley Law School has established criteria for the courses of instruction, the standards of achievement, and the period of residency necessary to ensure professional proficiency and practical scholarship in the law, and has also established the requirements for the degrees Juris Doctor and Master of Laws. The board has been advised that at the end of Michaelmas term 2021, 111 Juris Doctor students and 6 Master of Laws students of the class known as the Horace Gray class were examined and were found to have fulfilled all the requirements for those degrees. Now, therefore, it is resolved that the degrees are awarded once all grades have been calculated, and the candidates who are presented to the President and Dean of WMU Cooley Law School will receive the degree of Master of Laws or Juris Doctor at his hand. We do not have any of our LLM graduates walking today, but we would like you to know that the Master's of Laws degree, commonly known as the LLM degree, requires that the candidates complete 24 credits beyond the Juris Doctor in order to earn a credential that provides a legal specialization with global credibility. We wish our LLM graduates great success with their new degree. President and Dean McGrath, the faculty proudly presents Juris Doctor candidates from the Auburn Hills campus. Robert Charles Bush, Jr., magna cum laude. Kimberly D. Edwards. Tyranita Cherie Hughes, cum laude. Gianni Jabriel, cum laude. Reservist in the United States Army, Jason William Kolb. Robin Kwanzaa. Allison M. Hang on, Allison. Allison M. Samulon. Lynn LaRose Saunders, cum laude. Omar Mohammed Shajra, cum laude. Jessica Tatum, cum laude. Wesley J. Taylor, cum laude. Tara Ann Watson. Graduating from the Grand Rapids campus, Amy DeVries, cum laude. Kenneth Joseph Estefan. Jason D. Evans, cum laude. Gregory Fribley, magna cum laude. Emily Jo Goodwer, magna cum laude. Amanda Ingram, magna cum laude. Tristan Schuyler Kosmarek. Victoria Kendall Harina. Casey Strong, magna cum laude. And now graduating from the Lansing campus, Laura Christine Barrett. Matthew Bolt, cum laude. Corey A. Brevig, magna cum laude. Richard Abraham Chafee, cum laude. Brianne Meredith Coxon, magna cum laude. Catherine Annette Curitan. Reservist in the United States Air Force, Katrina Rochelle Davis. Chigo Zirim McShirley Igo Osuala, cum laude. Chartel D. Keith. Katie L. Komorowski, magna cum laude. Michelle Daniela Magallanes. Veteran of the United States Marine Corps, Adam M. Magnuson. Christian H. Miller, cum laude. Madeline Renee Omatansky, cum laude. Mary Catherine Pabich, magna cum laude. Veteran of the United States Army, Vallabh T. Rao, cum laude. Kristen D. Serrano. Veteran of the United States Army, Jordan William Swears, magna cum laude. Josie Renee Vander Galeen. I'm so sorry. Elizabeth M. Venema, magna cum laude. Mina Woodard, magna cum laude. And graduating from the Tampa Bay campus, Desiree Lachey Clark. Katie J. Michaels. Jennifer Waite. In March of 2020, like the rest of the world, we made a pivot to an online environment. And for that May graduating class and the following three graduating classes, we held virtual graduations. The students were good sports about it, but it just wasn't the same. So we told those graduates that when the day came that we could return to in-person graduations, they were welcome to attend so that they could have the opportunity to graduate in person and walk across the stage to receive their diplomas. This term, one of those took us up on that offer. I am so pleased to introduce graduating with the May 2020 Stephen Johnson Field class, Asia Nelson Lewis. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the graduates of the Horace Gray class.
President McGrath will now present the Stanley E. Beatty Teaching Award, along with his closing remarks.
Almost there. The Stanley E. Beattie Teaching Award was established in 1979 by the Board of Directors. The award is given to that member of the full-time faculty of the law school who, in the opinion of the graduating members of the Horace Gray class, has, during the preceding 3 years, made the greatest contribution to their legal education. And the winner is Professor Richard Henke. Professor Henke couldn't be here today, so I'll accept the award on his behalf. This will look great in my living room. All right. Well, again, graduates, congratulations on this very significant milestone in your life. When things get tough, I'm going to ask you to remember why you went to law school in the first place. And most of you come to law school with a sense of purpose. You want something as grand as changing the world, or maybe just changing the lives of yours and your families. Whatever the passion was that brought you here, and hopefully we've not completely beat it out of you, let that passion keep you going as you meet the challenges of your legal career. And speaking of challenges, sorry, I am that guy. For those of you who have not yet taken the bar exam, one big thing I'd like you to remember is how important your mindset is when you're preparing for the bar. Now you could say, I just graduated law school and now I have to take the bar exam. Or you could say, I just graduated law school and now I get to take the bar exam because it's a great privilege. Not everyone graduates college, but you did. And a very small number go to law school, but you did. An even smaller number graduates law school, and you did. So now you get to sit for the bar exam. And that's a privilege not many people get. And you've earned it. You've earned this horrible thing that's about to happen to you. But I am 100% confident all of you can do this. And if you ever feel like the preparation is overwhelming, and trust me, it will be, remember, you're doing all this hard work, not just for yourself, but for your colleagues, your family and friends. We're all here behind you. And we're here during your preparation, after it, if you want to talk with us, we're always here for you. So in closing, I want to once again thank everyone for sharing in our graduates' celebration of this incredible achievement. And graduates, although you're finishing up an important chapter in your life as a WMU Cooley student, that book is not finished. We're ready to share in your successes and any setbacks you may encounter as you become great lawyers and leaders. So stay in touch and become an active member in our alumni association. Stand tall with over 20,000 Cooley alums around the world and continue to make us all proud of you. And now it's my pleasure to hand you back to our host, Chris Rion. Take us home.
This concludes our commencement ceremony for the Horace Gray class. We ask that all guests remain seated until the members of the academic procession depart. Thank you.